Thank you and welcome everyone. Thank you for connecting to this session. I'm going to share with you our findings, the findings of this project entitled Automation and Jobs, how workers feel about this process. But before that, I want to share with you two anecdotes, anecdotes of moments that motivated me at the beginning of this process. One is about my first trip when I was starting this process. As you may know, we IMF economists travel to different countries to talk to country authorities. Once in Germany, when trying to grab a sandwich between meetings in ministries, I found myself in a situation very similar to this man. I used to stop at the same restaurant, a well-known chain, to grab a burger. And one day, instead of finding the usual guy trying to help me, I found myself having to order in this giant tablet. It is true that there was a lady trying to help us out, the new customers trying to get used to this tablet. But after a few days, she also disappeared. From that moment onwards, everyone had to order on that giant tablet, something that most of you have probably experienced already. At the time, already 3 years ago, I thought to myself, well, in this project in which I'm going to start thinking and surveying responses from workers, how do they feel about automation? Probably most of the answers are going to be negative because, you know, workers may feel replaced by these giant machines. But my view changed in my next trip when I arrived to India. Waiting outside the airport for a taxi, I saw this giant sign. It was red, very, you know, with lots of lights. And when the driver came, I asked him, can you please translate this? He was very kind and he said, yeah, I'm going to translate this to you because actually I'm thinking about changing from a taxi driver to becoming an Uber driver. And why would that be? I said, well, because look at the sign. They're telling us that if we join as drivers, we would be making about 1 lakh per month, which is about the average salary for the whole year. 1 lakh is about $1,300 US dollars. For a normal driver to make that, it would take not 1 month, but 5 months. The guy was really enthusiastic when telling me that story and actually making sure that I knew that he was going to transfer from becoming a taxi driver into an Uber driver. And I said, well, maybe the story is not so simple. Maybe this goes, you know, with personal characteristics and also the country that you live in, the type of opportunities that automation can bring to you. That is when I decided with my colleagues to start using not only survey data, but also hard data to combine data on robotization, job destruction, job creation, but also opinions from workers. And this was actually a process that, you know, took us about 2 years, and I'm sharing with you the main findings. First, we started looking at real hard data. We look at the penetration of robots, and we concentrated in the area of the world with the highest penetration of robots. As you can see in this chart, the number of robots in Europe is among the highest in the world. It's even higher than in the two other main economic blocks, higher than in the US and higher than in China. Within Europe, in Germany, we find the highest, strongest penetration of robots. Look, with 4.5 robots per 1,000 workers, Germany is the highest. We have some of the countries in Europe that have only about 1 robot per 1,000 workers. So there is a lot of divergence and dispersion. One of the novelties of this research is that we decided to look at the regional concentration of robotization. We actually used a new technique to assign robots at the country level to the regional level. Here I'm sharing with you two charts. On the left chart, you can see the change in the density of robots between 2006 and 2017. These are the first and the last year for which we have data on robots at the regional level in Europe. And on the right chart, you see the change in employment rates for the same period in the same regions. And as you can see, the areas with dark green color are more or less the same, Central and Eastern European countries. This is the area basically where during that period, robotization and employment creation were compatible, happened at the same time. When looking at this econometrically, we actually can see that the change in robot exposure, which is the horizontal axis in this chart, actually is associated with positive changes in the employment rate, which is the vertical axis in this chart. Just to give you an idea, for a 1% change in the penetration of robots during this period, there was an increase in employment of about 0.12%. Look, this is a major novelty because until now, until this research, the evidence from outside Europe was saying that, well, the relationship between robotization and employment was probably negative, either non-significant or in most cases negative, for example, with data from the US. But they were using data from the late 90s and the beginning 2000s. When using data more recent from 2006 onwards, we see that actually there is some sort of a positive relationship. It's not maybe that the story is only about substitution of workers by robot, but maybe there is a more positive message, more complementarities. And maybe humans and robots can cooperate and there are complementarities. This is what we wanted to explore, but we also wanted to look at what workers think about all this process. Let me turn to that part of the project now. When we ask workers with the help of Boston Consulting Group and Harvard Business School, 11,000 workers in 11 countries, both advanced and emerging economies, how did they feel about automation? Most of them felt positive. Actually, 42% of respondents thought that automation would be positive for their job and for the workplace. Only 25% of them thought that, you know what, probably I think that is going to have a negative impact going forward. Country differences matter a lot. If you see this chart, you can, for example, follow the trends in blue. And in India and Indonesia, 55% of workers on average responded positively about the impact of automation. The story is different in Germany or in Sweden. Maybe workers had the same feeling that I had when I went into that restaurant chain and I ordered my burger and there was a tablet instead of a person in front of me. 30% of respondents in those countries, Germany and Sweden, responded positively about this. Other countries like the US, France, or Spain are somewhat in between, with 40% of respondents, being positive about this process. Probably it is not only country characteristics, but also personal characteristics of respondents what matter. And we looked into this. Let me share with you a summary of our main findings in a single chart. When asked about how do you feel about the future of work, respondents' characteristics and country factors matter. To give you an example, look at the blue bars in this chart. The dark blue bars summarize the findings with respect to personal characteristics, and the light blue bars the findings with respect to how country factors affect the responses. The first bar shows the following. A college graduate is 70% more likely to find a positive impact of automation on the future of work than a high school graduate. So education matters. Something similar happens when you are satisfied with your job or when you're making good money. You tend to respond more positively about this question. On the contrary, older workers are 65% less likely to be positive about the impact of automation on the future of work. Something similar happens when you have experienced job volatility in the recent past. Looking at country characteristics, respondents in those countries that have actually went through a process of intense automation between 2000 and 2016, they had a bad experience probably, and there was some sort of a negative association between respondents in those countries and how they view the future of automation. In contrast, those respondents in countries with strong labor protection or in emerging market economies saw this thing about, like an opportunity, and they preferred to respond positively about how they saw this future. In this context, we also asked workers, how do you think companies are going to react to this process? What is going to be demanded from you? Most of them thought, 55% of them replied that they expected companies to require more skills. And when we asked them, so who do you think is responsible for preparing you for the future of work? Most of them said, well, I am the one responsible, not the government, not the companies. This was a bit surprising. But again, here, country differences matter as well. If you look at emerging economies, in general, the dark blue bars tell you that about 60% of respondents, 60 to 65% of respondents in emerging economies, thought that they were the ones responsible for preparing them, not the government, not the companies, for getting them ready for the future of work. In advanced economies, the situation was a bit different. With the exception of the US, there was some a stronger role for governments and companies, at least in the view of respondents. a good example is France, which actually, tells you that respondents, the majority of them found that it was the government, not the company, not themselves, the one who should be responsible for preparing them for the future of work. In Japan and in Germany, with a long tradition on on-the-job training, they actually found that there was a strong role for the company. These conclusions are important because this can help policymakers legislate, prepare the next generation of rules in the labor market. In general, when workers were asked about how they felt they could be prepared for the future of work, they said, well, I'm willing to take on education and reskilling, but I need some new legislation, new benefits, and maybe time and a little bit of money to go and re-educate myself. In summary, this project shows evidence of recent complementarities between workers and robots. The hard data coming from Europe, one of the highest of the areas in the world with highest penetration of robots, tells us that there has been a weakly positive association between robots and job creation during the last decade. Information from the service tells us that the workers' view are positive. They are positive, especially if they are younger, they are more educated, they have job stability and or more labor protection in their country. They're ready to prepare themselves for the future of work, but they expect governments to legislate new benefits to make, their working environment more flexible so that they could engage into retraining. And also they will welcome some new legislation, to have more time and more money to prepare for the future of work. I hope you find these findings useful and enlightening for the open debate that we're going to have now. Thank you. I will take your questions.